my hearted gratitude to Muslim Institute for honoring me this opportunity. I need more than 15 years to converge the rays that are coming out from each single pearl and to embellish the whole environment with it. But I would pray to God that I could do justice to this real worth of treasure. Masnavi and Manvi, it's a skylight illumination, philosophical artifact, and it is the idea of the divine breath based on divine love of Hazrat Arif Maulana Jalaluddin Rumi Rahmatullah Alayh. According to Rumi's philosophy, life should be a journey to union with the one true God, which is achieved by practicing love, self-discovery, and self-transcendence, by disregarding oneself as an independent being and turning towards the truth of God's oneness. You all know the phenomenon of Wahdatul Wujud. It's all talking about the phenomenon of Wahdatul Wujud. Here I would say that this great artifact, Masnavi and Manvi, came into being as a result of the most significant occasion that happened to Rumi in 641 Hijri. When he was 37 years old, he met Shamsuddin Muhammad Tabrizi, or Shams of Tabriz in Konya. The prompt outcome of that spiritual and emotional experience had changed the chart of his life from an established teacher and jurist into an ascetic, you can say, poet. And as he said in his first verse, as stated by his son, Sultan Al-Walad, Bishnuwas nai chu hikayat mi kunad, was judai hai shikayat mi kunad. Ask the flute how well he registered the complaint and how well he articulated the pain of separation. So this was the pain of separation, the agony that made Maulana, that bring a drastic, or you can say a turning point in Maulana Rumi's life. So here we can say this divine breath, that is Masnavi and Manvi, here Rumi reflects human sufferings and the role it plays in the spiritual journey. He argues that sufferings act as a catalyst for growth and transformation and serves to lead humans towards deeper understanding of themselves and their Rabb. As it is said by Hazrat Yahya bin Mas Rahmatullah Alayh, Man arafa nafsahu faqad arafa rabbahu. So those who discover themselves, they discover their Rabb. Human psychology and character building in the light of Masni and Manvi, which is merely a small fragment of Rumi illumination, yet very deeper than an ocean. So if we talk about, or before starting on this topic, I will say humanity today is facing unprecedented challenges, and there is consensus that we are in a defining moment of our human history. A defining moment is a moment when we are faced with an unavoidable choice. The consequence of our choice will determine whether we survive and develop as a unified humanity or descend into greed, conflict, and chaos, unlike Ashraful Makhlukat. Maulana Jalaluddin Muhammad Rumi was a renowned Sufi, spiritual teacher, poet, and Islamic theologian who has attracted both scholarly and non-scholarly attention all over the world. Rumi's teaching and work has gained international reputation and acceptance. This is the reason that UNESCO declared the year 2007, that was the 800th anniversary of Rumi, as the year of Rumi, which confirms his prominence and acceptance. Is it mere an accident or coincidence that we should be honoring this great human being at this time? Is there any other figure in human history that all of humanity could honor in this way at this critical moment in our history? Why? Because he is the scholar without boundaries. His message is for all. It is not bound to any religion, any creed, any ethnicity. So that's why he is given this much prominence. So when we talk about human psychology, there are many people who still don't know about psychology. First, I will tell you what human psychology is. It refers to the study of human nature, or you can say how the human mind and mental processes are working. The human nature that inspires or motivates behavior and actions. It helps identify the innate human resources and potentials to survive. There are two major paradigms when we talk about psychology. Western paradigm and Islamic paradigm. I would not go into detail into Western paradigm. Simply, I will say the Western paradigm is narrowed down into three school of thoughts. One is psychoanalysis, humanistic, and radical behaviorism. So when we talk about psychoanalysis and radical behaviorism, it is all, you know, different fields. But when we talk about humanistic psychology, they are very close to the Islamic psychology. So I would prefer to pay attention to the Islamic psychology here. The study of manifestation of Allah in nature as reflected in the behavioral pattern of all living and non-living organisms in all walks of their lives using Islamic paradigm. Human psychology with Islamic perspective, the concept of human nature given by Islamic psychology is based on the ideas present in the Quran and Sunnah. According to Islam, man being the best and honored creation of Allah on earth has been blown the spirit of Allah, spirit of life by Allah, the Almighty, the Ruh, soul in the human body. It is the divine spark of God in man. And remember, Ruh has always a upward gravity pull because it is from Allah, so it always has upward gravity pull. And then man has been given the amana, the trust, the khilafa, vicegerency, fitra, primordial nature. Fitra, what is fitra? Everybody is born with fitra, the salima. It is an inherent trait to differentiate between the bad and the good, the evil and the good. So the man is also equipped with fitra. Then mithaq, then God consciousness, what we call marifat in Sufism. Being provided with all these, man has to actualize all these strengths, potentials, qualities, innate knowledge, and fulfill the very purpose for which he has been sent to the world. And he can perform the duties being the caliph of Allah in this world. And man in his attempt and struggle to actualize all his hidden and innate potentials just to achieve the khudi, which is stated by Iqbal in a great detail. Man in his attempt and struggle to actualize all the potential which dormant within his inner self and overcome the base element of his psyche known as nafs-e-amara. My dear colleague, Laik Ahmed, has very well described about nafs-e-amara. But I would add something to it, that nafs-e-amara has always a downward pull towards dunya, towards hawa, towards lust, desires. If you can see the diagram, basically as we or maximum of the world are now following the Islamic psychology, so when we diagnose the different psychological problems, we use this conceptual linear diagram, which shows the trajectories, which shows why we are getting psychological disorders. And it is in very much in compliance with the Rumi's teaching. So this is how you can see nafs has a downward pull and the Ruh has upper pull. Here he has, Laik Sahab has talked very well about nafs-e-amara and then you can say when the heart mukallibal kulub state, that is nafs-e-lawama and then mulhima and then mutmaina. But he missed one, that is nafs-e-raziya. It is also stated in Surah Fajr, nafs-e-raziya. The state which I can say, as it is stated in Ainul Faqr, when you attain the state of faqir, you go into the state of razia. Razia means you are razi with divine raza. You have no personal life. You have no individual personality. Whatever you are given from the divine is your raza. So this is what I wanted to add to it. The rest he explained very well, so that's why I'm skipping. Okay, so when we talk about Islamic psychology, as Rumi and all other Sufi, they describe very well, man has dual nature, physical and spiritual. Okay, so Quran is a guidebook for man, not only explains man's biological and mental markups, religious and moral obligation, but also man's spiritual dimensions. Human nature explains that man was in the form of spirit before he became a recipient of his body. Upon the demise of an individual, though the physical body decomposes, this is very much you can easily comprehend this, that after death, what happens? The physical body decomposes and the soul will go into the to live and attain immortality in another dimension of life. And this is Islamic psychology. The spiritual dimension of man has been explained using term like al-ruh, al-kalb, al-nafs, and al-akl. You can see kalb and akl is in the center. Okay? So they have the central position. That's why we are saying that if you want to become insan-e-kamil, you have to get or you can achieve the akl-e-salima and kalb-e-salim. Okay? So these are very important. Because fitrat-e-salima we are all born with. So what we want need to struggle is akl-e-salim and kalb-e-salim in order to get our that self-actualization, which is always explained by Quran, Sunnah, and all of the Sufis and our spiritual scholars. Okay, then as it is said that when man came to this world, it was in the form of ruh that took the shape into the body. And after demise, again, the body will decompose. So there's a famous Arabic quote, Kullu shayin yarji'u ila asli. All the things will return to its origin. So this is all about that when we say wahdatul wujud, that is union to the God. It is all that, as Allah has stated in Quran, lo, we have created Adam with our attributes. So we have to return to him. Human psychology in the light of Masnavi and Manvi, theme of Manvi, Masnavi Manvi, book number 1 and 2, they are principally concerned with the nafs, again, the lower carnal self. Why the lower? Because it is pushing down towards the world, towards hawa, towards lust, towards shaitan. That's why it's called the, Maulana Rumi called it the lower carnal self. And it's self-deception. As if you have read Masnavi Manvi, there's a story, the lion and the beast. What happens to the lion? When he was taken to the well by the rabbit, that there is your enemy, your foe, who is going to eat your meal. You can kill that animal. So what the lion is did is that he just saw inside the well and he saw his own reflection. And as a result, he jumped into the well to kill his enemy and he was killed himself. So this is all self-deception. As he said that nafs, if you want to reach to the upper rank of nafs, you have to work both inside, outside. It is not only outside. You have to gain self-awareness, what's going on in your inside. That how Maulana Rumi's poetry is used as a therapeutic tool for psychiatric illnesses. You have seen that Masnavi and Manvi is full of stories, fables, tales. So these are bibliotherapeutic tales. As we have studied or did PhD in our Western psychology, we use many stories from Erikson, while treating or while dealing the patients, applying them NLP therapy. So if you can see, and if you can see the result of the research that is done in Ankara, there are thousands of patients who are sent to the shrines of Rumi and they listen to that saas, to that poetry, and they are recovered from illness. So the bibliotherapeutic stories are playing a very great role in this field, psychological field. And I'm very thankful for Muslim Institute who gave me this topic because it opened my eyes. And now I'm going to join any of the Turkish university to train myself in this because it's very much important. The first is drive holistic excellence through God consciousness in life and action. How we think about ourselves, how we behave can determine how we think about God. How we perceive God in our mind can affect our self-understanding. The cardinal importance of all religious belief in this world put emphasis on knowing ourselves. Man arafa nafsahu, faqad arafa rabbahu. Sabse pehle hame khud ko janna hai, self-awareness gain karni hai, taake hum Allah ki marifat hasil kare. Aur mere khayal mein usi mein hamari bahut character building ho jati hai when we move from through a pathway, through a spiritual pathway, starting from nafse amara, moving towards nafse lawama, then joining the nafse mulhima and so on. So this is the spiritual journey. And throughout this journey, what we are doing? We are gaining God consciousness. marifat. We are gaining, we are knowing Allah. After we know about each other, about our inner self. And then we have second, self-regulation is very much important because this is how you self-regulate. As I told you, you can see Aql is in the center, Nafs is downward, Ruh, Fitra, which are the positive attitudes, are upward. So you can self-regulate. And there are many ways how to strengthen your Nafs-e Lawama by having a company of good people. Okay, sitting with good people, listening to the good things. Then Mulhima, Mutmainna, reciting Quran, Ibadat. Helping, especially participating in the charity work, strengthen your Nafs-e Lawama. So, self-regulation is very much important. And if it is, you start in the very beginning with the children, children are very, very expert in learning these self-regulation skills. Then we have instill love and compassion. As Hazrat Sultan Bahu, my beloved quote of Hazrat Sultan Bahu, that container drips what it contains. If you have love, compassion, then only you can give love and compassion to your surroundings. It's not only your brothers and sisters, it's all your living, non-living, flora, fauna, plants, all your environment. So the container drips what it contains. We should instill love and compassion. So this is, again, I'm really sorry. It's a very little time and the topic needs individually a separate seminar. So that we can understand what Masnavi and Manvi can help the psychologists of the world and how it can strengthen Islamic psychology throughout the world and even without boundaries. Because when we talk about it has strengthened the Jungian psychologist Masnavi Manvi. There is a story about, I think so, the elephant and the there's a character in it. It is talking about the psychoanalysis, the Jungian therapies. It tells about the Carl Rogers principles of therapy, unconditional positive regard, empathy, genuineness. So please, I request Muslim Institute to keep one separate seminar on this so that we can help the psychologists all over the world to be equipped with the Muslim psychology. Thank you very much.